Hi everyone, my name is Jack. I'm a second year student here. I also do second study comp screen as well. I wanted to talk about music for video games today. Specifically one video game soundtrack which is particularly iconic and adored by its player base. For the most part, Minecraft, yeah. I played this game a lot when I was kind of like 10, 11, early teens. Didn't do it for quite a number of years until I got back into it with one of my mates last year. And then I ended up actually making a Minecraft club at PCV, which is the student digs at RCM, for those of you who don't know. I'm moving out this year, which is nice. So the Minecraft soundtrack, up until very recently, was written exclusively by this guy. He was called Daniel Rosenfeld, and he goes by the name of C418 as well. He wrote two main volumes, Volume Alpha and Volume Beta. Those are the two kind of album artworks. And then like a few other bits and bobs after that. I was wondering, who's heard any of this, even just like 30 seconds? Yeah, most people, almost everyone. The thing is, what makes this soundtrack so iconic? Compositionally, it's mostly pretty simple. Some of the track titles are just, like, bizarre. And in terms of production, it's not, like, super impressive either. But I think, for the most part, it probably lies in how well C418 kind of captures the essence of the game. So, for example, like, if you were told to write music for a video game, you'd probably be told, we need something of X length that has this kind of vibe to it, and it'll appear when the player gets to this stage of the game. So, like, for example, a boss fight or something. And we need it to be able to, like, loop every minute and a half. And they're pretty clear instructions. They're quite limiting, but the advantage is you know what kind of job you have to do. The problem with Minecraft and the problem that C418 would have had to face is that the player can basically be anywhere at any point and do whatever they like at any time. How on earth do you write music for this thing? For example, you can't really write a piece when a player is in a specific location, so like a desert or something, because they could just go in and then fly out 3 seconds later. Are you going to write a piece that can loop every 2 seconds? No. Terry Wright would probably do that, but that wouldn't really work. And the kind of solution that C418 came up with, which I think works really well, is to basically write music that can fit almost anywhere. And the game plays it at totally random times, and it seemingly just seems to work whenever it comes on. And that's probably because the music doesn't really aim to capture a specific place or specific kind of points of, you know, in-game progress, so it doesn't really matter if you're like, you know, you've just got wood for the first time or you've just like killed the Ender Dragon. The same music can kind of play in the same way, and it doesn't matter where you are either. You know, you can be like at the top of a jungle tree or deep in a cave or something. But I think the music it captures the essence of the game as a whole, and I think it does that in quite a few ways. It's got a bit of a kind of ambient sound to it, not overly so. There aren't like 8 second long reverbs applied to it, which I may or may not have done in my Concert 21 piece. And it's not kind of epic, but it's not necessarily depressing either. But the one thing that most people seem to agree on is it's kind of got this sort of nostalgic feeling about it. And I think that's really important. I mentioned a little bit earlier that the player can basically be anywhere at any time or do anything they want at any point. And I think they can be doing things like building houses, mining, fighting things, or enslaving NPC villages and other lovely things like that. Of course, players remember some things they do, even just in a small amount of resolution, if you like. They don't remember like precisely what they did all the time, but kind of roughly speaking. And that kind of leads to an individual experience, if you like. And I think the nostalgic nature of the music means that it helps players connect with their own individual experience of the game as they kind of go through it. Especially me, having kind of like played it a bit when I was sort of 11, 12, 13, something like that. It definitely impacts me in that way. And I think that's probably a big reason why the music is successful. Even though it's the same music to everyone, it has a slightly different meaning for each individual player. And that's kind of point of the game too, you know. It's the same game for everyone, it's the same code, but everyone's individual experience is slightly different. That's why I think it's successful. So I wanted to go into a bit more detail about, this is a nostalgic house, by the way, I found it on Google. I wanted to go into a bit more detail about one specific track from the first album, so Volume Alpha, the one that was released first. This one's called Sweden. And the reason I picked this one was because I think it kind of epitomizes a lot of the points I made earlier on. So I'm going to just like play the first couple of minutes of it. And then just like look at a couple of things from like a compositional standpoint. So Sweden. So that was the first kind of couple of minutes. Here's a kind of slightly dodgy score I found off MuseScore of it. I think it's, for the most part, pretty accurate. Before I kind of get into anything remotely complex, just like the first immediate thing is I kind of noticed. I mean, like, look at the tempo. Like, it's slow. It's very slow. And I think when you want a kind of ambient-ish track, you probably don't want something that's kind of like in your face or that might make you want to dance or, you know, get your heart rate ticking up a bit. I guess it's a simple enough point, but a valid one nonetheless. And most of this track is also dominated by solo piano. Indeed, it starts just with solo piano. The screen book composers in the room especially will know that, you know, just having like a solo instrument can go quite a long way to creating a kind of lonely or isolated feeling. And many of the tracks in both albums, especially the first one, are kind of dominated by a solo instrument. And I think this works because, especially the kind of Minecraft in its earlier days, particularly, it's often quite a lonely game. You're often alone, you know, trying to survive in a world that's basically more than 8 times the size of Earth. If we get a bit more into the nitty gritty of it, I mean, harmony. Who here likes harmony? Yeah, most people. You guys don't like harmony. That's fine. there are a lot of these types of chords that I've highlighted. I had more of a look at these, and you could sort of label them in a few different ways. sort of G major 9, B major 9, because that's kind of what they are. You could also label them like this. Or actually, you can actually notate them as slash chords as well. So you can kind of understand them in a few different ways. But I think this is the best label for them. And it's like this particular type of chord. I just call it a Minecraft chord because I think that's basically what they are. And all they are basically is they're just major ninth chords, but a lot of the time without a third in. And you can also think of them again like a slash chords with the kind of fourth degree of the above the root as the bass line. Yeah, block chords, maybe. Although that's kind of an accompaniment technique, maybe. and these Minecraft chords, as I call them, they also appear in other titles. So this one's called Wet Hands. I told you the titles were pretty weird. And you can see there it's got a couple of them, and like there's even like four bars of just one of them just straight there. Those do have a third, so they're maybe not a totally pure Minecraft chord, but something close to it anyway. And you actually find these types of chords quite a lot in sort of like lo-fi music. So like I found just like a random example off the internet. I literally looked about 30 seconds and find this. And you know, these have got an E flat Minecraft chord there, G flat one as well. And I guess a last point about Sweden in particular is it's kind of a grand bass piece. So you've got this bass line that literally repeats every two bars. And almost identical chord patterns every single time. So it kind of gives it a little bit of a kind of lamenting feel. Like this track is probably one of the more kind of sad sounding ones. It's not like really sad, but it's a little bit sad and definitely nostalgic as well. I don't know, like Dido's Lament's quite a good example of that kind of grand bass sort of thing. And probably what chips into that as well is the kind of the melodic sort of motifs that make up that melody are kind of mostly like downwards facing, you know, dun, 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 that kind of stuff comes up loads and loads. I wanted to like open it up to questions because it's quite a lot to like unpack. So if anyone has any questions, fire away. Yeah.
What's your opinion on the most recent soundtrack that they added for the Lord Composers?
Ah, okay.
I don't think this is good. But it's interesting.
Because, I mean, I was talking about earlier how, like, music is very not location-specific. Yeah. The new stuff that's coming out now is more location-specific. So, like, I won't bore everyone with details about it, but, like, there are kind of these specific tracks that will come on in very, very specific locations, which I'm not sure they work, to be honest, because sometimes I hear it and I'm like, I've heard this before, and then I suddenly walk out somewhere else, and I'm like, I don't know what this thing's about. So, I mean, I like them. But I think the reason C41 didn't compose them was because of a licensing issue. As far as I know, he basically, the way it worked with, like, the first... with these two ones, and the ones after, was basically he still had the rights to the music, and it was licensed to Mojang, the company who makes it. Then Microsoft took it over, I can't remember when, but quite a few years ago, and basically wanted to like have it as a kind of right to hire thing, kind of like film studios do, and he didn't want to do it, so that's why someone else ended up doing it. But yeah, I like them. I think they kind of work, but I think these two, especially the first one, will always kind of be the OG Minecraft soundtrack. Yeah, cool.
Oh, yeah, since you sell stuff like all like the sound called like Minecraft music, would you say you use like any aspects of the like to some degree like with your own
music? Yeah, maybe a little bit. I mean, I tend to be one of those people who sort of absorbs stuff they hear. So, like, generally, a lot of the time, stuff I write will kind of be a sort of weird combination of a lot of things I listen to, obviously with my own kind of interpretation and process thrown into it. Because I do listen to this music sometimes, like, when I'm not playing the game, because I just like it. And Yeah, so I guess it certain parts probably have some influence. I couldn't point to an example of exactly where, but I'm sure they would do. Yeah, it's interesting. For a lot of people, they probably would be, but for me, I probably kind of compartmentalized it a bit. So I kind of, maybe if I thought about it more, I'd start thinking about that stuff in my own day-to-day, but like, I kind of, you know, when I'm sort of like on the game or something, I kind of don't really tend to think about stuff like that. So like for me, it may be, it's its own kind of little world, so to speak. So it hasn't really like, you know, I don't get onto a bus thinking, oh, is this like the right music for me to be on, you know, listening to on a bus or something? Yeah.
Does anyone do that? I mean, walking down the street? Yeah. Jack, that's really interesting. Thank you very much. We look forward to seeing some of your video game music soon.
Yeah, well, one can.